Before they met, they were praying to God that if it's His will to find someone to share life with. And not just a life, but a Christian home with. Someone that they would share like beliefs and be able to somehow be able to honor God and more being together than being separate. That there was more they could do to bless the human family together than on their own. And as they prayed, eventually they met. Is it just around where you live? Is it a parking lot even? Or
courtyard.
Just a courtyard area there. And my understanding is that they, at that moment, didn't say, that's the one. But after they got to get to know each other, little bit by little bit, they would talk more and more about spiritual things. And they realized that they both really shared a deep affection for Christ. And it is that affection for Christ that I believe that the two of you ultimately fell in love with one another. And ever since then, they have simply continued to grow together as one. And that's true, and that's really what our message could be about, is about them coming to meet each other and beginning a married life, but you're going to become closer to one another than you are right now. And this is a special moment, and I believe this really is a divine appointment, because this is an answer to prayer that God would bring them together. And I do believe God is present here with us, beholding the very institution that he started. So in our sermonette, they had asked me to share three verses with you. You heard two of them. Genesis chapter 2, verse 24, about how a man and a woman come together and become one flesh. Then there's another verse, and I'll do this in the order I'll be speaking. They shared with me the idea of sharing Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25, where it says that husbands, love your wife, even as Christ loved the church, and he gave himself for it. And then you heard, of course, 1 Corinthians 13. 1 Corinthians 13 is what we call the love chapter. It is a chapter that tells us what the ingredients of love are. You know, love isn't just one thing. It's like if you can think of your favorite recipe, it's not just one ingredient, it's many ingredients. If you take away one of them, it doesn't quite taste the same. And so love is many things, but the bottom line of love is to do good all the time to everybody all the time, and to do good and nothing but good all the time to everybody. And you'd say, well, how could we be that loving? Is that possible? Is it possible to do good and nothing but good all the time to everybody? And this is, of course, how this lovely couple will ultimately be able to draw together as one. Okay? And I'd like to begin this thought on love in Genesis at the very beginning. I'd like to start with an ancient story. We have, of course, David and Antoinette, but then before them was Adam and Eve. And before Adam and Eve, there was who? There was God. And the Bible opens that in the beginning, God created heaven and earth. Before there was ever any one of us, before there was an Adam and Eve, God had conceived of this beautiful couple of Adam and Eve, conceived of this beautiful planet. And we look around us and we realize that God created everything. And the word created in the Hebrew is bara, meaning that he created everything out of nothing. He simply spoke and there's a sphere. He speaks and there's plants. He speaks and there's animals and there's birds that fill our air with song. But the most wonderful thing that God created was to create mankind in his own image. But what do we learn from this creation story where we find marriage? The first thing we learn is that God is the creator. And I want to use a different word. That God is the source. The times when we fall apart from one another is when we forget that God's the source of everything that's good and everything that's eternal. And we try to become our own God. Come up with our own rules and regulations, when in fact it's this loving God who created this beautiful world for us, and he's the source of all of it. And he didn't just create it. In the book of Colossians, in Colossians chapter 1, and it says in verse 16 and following, for by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are on earth. And then in verse 17 it says, and he is before all things, and by him all things consist. You see, God didn't just create a world and let it go. Everything consists. It's the Greek word that means he actually holds it all together. And I've had opportunities to talk to different PhDs, people who are scientists, and they say to me, Jeff, we still don't know how atoms hold together. We understand the laws of gravity, but still, how does the earth stay in its perfect orbit around the sun? And we say laws of nature, but the reality is God simply uses the laws of nature as his instrument. He uses the laws of nature as his agents. He uses them and he holds it all together. He's the one that actually makes the seeds to grow and to germinate and bear fruit. He does supply the needs of this human family. And if it was out without him, the source, and then also the sustainer. God is the source of all joy and the sustainer that keeps us in that joy. And so in your life together, it's waking up every day remembering that God is the source of your happiness and he'll always be the sustainer of that. And what happens oftentimes in marriages is we turn away. We become our own God, we have our own ideas, and it causes divisions. And we forget that God is the source of joy. And he's the sustainer of life. Even our hearts, even right now, are beating because God is love. And so when we think about marriage and we think about always putting God first. And here's a couple that put God first by praying to God and say, my partner will be your choice, not my choice. And patiently waiting, God brought this beautiful couple together to share a life together. Now, in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25, where it says, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ loved the church. If we think about what that says there, how's that possible? How can a husband love his wife as much as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it? And I think about that and I say, you know, it's not possible. As much as I love my wife, I could never love her in my own power as much as Christ loves me and everybody else in the human family. But you know, if God's the source, and if God's the sustainer, if I were to receive his love, and his love would be in my heart towards my wife, then I could love my wife as much as he loves me and the human family. And let me give you an example. Years ago, we lived in this home out in Wisconsin. And we had left for the day. And someone came into our house. We came home and a neighbor said, you know, someone came into your house while you were gone. And I said, oh boy. And in our house, we had hid like $300. So the first thing I did when I got home and I was told this man went into our house for just a few minutes and left, the first thing I checked was to see if my $300 was there. Well, guess what? It was gone. Now, I can assure you that I didn't have a bunch of warm, fuzzy feelings about this person. And I knew that the feelings that I had were wrong. And yet I know the Bible says, love even your enemies. And at that point, I realized I was fully incapable of doing that. And I prayed. And I said, Father, I don't love this man. I don't love what he did. And I don't love him. And I said, Father, I know I wasn't even born with that kind of love. But I want it. I do want to be able to forgive this man, and I do want to be able to love this person. But I realized that the only way I could do it is if I remember that God is what? He's the source of that love. And that God is the sustainer, that he could keep me in that kind of love. And so I prayed to the Father, and I said, Father, let me have your love for this man, because I know you don't love what he did, but you love him. You sent your own son into the world to die for him like everybody else. No matter what he would do, no matter how many times he would do it. And I said, Father, would you share your love with me so that I can love him with your love and love him as you love him? And you know, if we pray that kind of prayer, will God answer that kind of prayer? Absolutely. And so when I prayed that prayer and I felt that I had God's love in my heart for this man, I went to his house and I knocked on the door. And he answered the door. And the first thing I said was, I know you took my $300, but I want you to know that I forgive you and that you're worth a lot more than $300. You see, what had to happen there is God had to change not just his heart. God had to change my heart. And after that, we got to study the Bible together, and that man accepted Christ into his life. But you see, that would have never happened if I thought I was the source of love. If I thought that it was something I could do myself, that would have never happened. And so the only way that a husband can love his wife as Christ loves the church is to receive that kind of love. And if we ask for it, we'll receive it. Won't matter what our spouse has said or done in the past, those barriers, they can all come down, because the remedy for all our problems, we heard in that song, is love. And it's the kind of love we're not born with, but it's the kind of love we can be born again with. And that is the message of the gospel. Is that we're not just to be a people who are improved, but a people who are changed. To be able to live a life we could never do by ourselves, but only by Him who's the source of life and the sustainer of life. Now in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, which we heard read, is those ingredients of love. And if I spend just a minute just making a comment on these various beautiful ingredients. It says in verse 4, charity or love suffereth long and is kind. You know, when Paul, under inspiration, is giving us this ingredients of love, he's going to tell us what love is and what love isn't. And the first thing he tells us is something about what it is. He says, love is long-suffering and it's kind. How often? Every person in every situation. You say, well, that's not possible. But it is possible. How? Because God is love. Because God's the source. And He will share Himself with us. That's His glory, is to recreate us in the image of Jesus Christ. So love is long-suffering and love is kind. Have you ever met a person who rubbed you the wrong way? Do you ever have those clashes of personality? Do you know what the answer is? The only remedy for that is what? Is love. If you return unkind words with unkind words, it's an absolute disaster. The only way to remedy a situation with someone who rubs you the wrong way is to love them. Love is patient, love is long-suffering, love is kind. And he tells us that love also does not envy. Love isn't jealous. Love does not feel inferior. And love doesn't make yourself feel superior. Love doesn't worry about somebody else having more attainments or more money. Love is simply isn't jealous. And in our world of inequality, and even now, the things that are happening in our cities, what's the remedy? It's love. Where's that love come from? It comes from up there. God has to be the source of that love, because none of us were born with that kind of love, but we can be born again. He tells us that love is not puffed up, vaunteth not itself. It doesn't like display in an ostentatious way its successes. Love is humble. Love thinks of service, not of being served. Love, it says, does not act unseemly. What does it mean to act unseemly? Perhaps arrogant, emotional, imbalanced. But you know, love is kind, love is balanced, love is judicious, love is winsome. Love draws people. You never heard anyone say, you know what I like about Bob? He's so rude. You never hear anything like that. But you might hear someone say, you know, I like Bob because he's so kind. He's so courteous. You see, love makes all the difference. And it's as you draw closer to Christ, each one of you individually, and they will spend time studying the life of Christ together, as all of us should. We should all spend time every day in communion with Him who gave us life and Him who sustains our life, because without Him, we can't do these things. But with Him, we can do all things. And it's as they grow in Christ that Jesus and Dave and the Jesus and Antoinette will actually draw them closer together. And the more that Jesus is in their life, the more they become one. One in purpose, one in thoughts, even though two distinct personalities, but that beautiful agreement together and life together. It says, love seeketh not her own, doesn't always have to have its own way, is not easily provoked, and thinketh no evil. You know, love doesn't keep a record of wrongs. Love forgives. Love doesn't remind people of things just to provoke. It's just the opposite. Love doesn't like conflict. Love tries to solve conflict and bring peace. Love heals everything. Love rejoices not in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Love doesn't rejoice when someone does wrong. Doesn't rejoice when things go wrong. Just the opposite. Love really wants things to work. Love wants people to be happy and to be able to fulfill their dreams. And lastly, love beareth all things, believeth all things, hopes all things, endure all things. Love never fails. It bears all things. Love has a way of enduring, sticking with it, and not giving up on people. It hopes all things, doesn't look at anybody as hopeless, as if they've sinned too many times, or a situation is hopeless, and say, no, we can remedy this if we just had what? That love of Christ. We have hope. If we have love, we have hope. If we have love, we can bear all things. And if we have love, we can believe all things. That doesn't mean we believe everything we hear, but we believe the best about people. We believe the best about a situation and not assume the worst. Love never fails. Love never fails because it includes all the ingredients we just talked about. And for your marriage to be so blessed, it will depend on this key. God has to be the source of your joy and your happiness and your love between you. And always increasing, always, every day, increasing your faith in Him and your trust in Him. And then you shall do wonderful, wonderful things together. I know you two have already been doing wonderful things together, but now as you become one, God needs couples who put God first. And the devil's trying to destroy family. And God's trying to restore it. And that restoration begins with the source and the sustainer and love. May God richly bless every family represented here.
Amen.
And I know that it's my joy to have met each one of you. I don't know you personally, but I've had a chance to meet the family of David and Antoinette, who've meant a lot to me. May your home be a place where angels love to dwell. A place where each one of you finds an environment to draw closer and closer to Christ. An environment of love. At this time, Elder Bodie is going to lead us in prayer.
gathered here this day of May 31st, 2020, by invitation to witness David and Antoinette's union as one.
Amen.
Being blessed by our Heavenly Father and abiding in Him, that when He appears, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before Him at His coming. If you know that He is righteous, you know that everyone who practices righteousness is born of Him. May the future of David and Antoinette Horner be crowned with the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the enemy. May peace and blessings be with you to eternity. Amen. At this time, we will do the Lord's Prayer in unison found in your program. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
We come to the very important part of our service where both of them will make a public commitment. I am reading the vows and I will repeat it. So listen carefully. I, David, take you, Antoinette, to be my wife.
I, David, take you, Antoinette, to be my wife.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
For better. For worse.
For better or for worse.
For richer or poorer.
For richer or poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love, cherish, and obey.
To love, cherish, and obey.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
Till death do us apart.
Till death do us apart.
In the presence of God, family and friend.
In the presence of God, family and friend,
I make this vow. Okay. Okay, put it down here. I, Antoinette, take you, David, to be my husband.
I, Antoinette, take you, David, to be my husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love, cherish, and obey. From this day forward,
from this day forward,
till death do us apart,
till death do us apart,
in the presence of God and the family and friend, I make this vow to you. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my privilege, by the authority of the Holy Scriptures and the state of the law of Ohio, to announce, or not announce, introduce them as husband and wife. You may kiss her. No, this time it's your wife.
Shall travel on to where